please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
We're asking Mr. Shah about the banking space. Eventually, he will be part of the banking board bureau as well. But today, in the last 24 hours, the cue has been that the Reserve Bank intends to stay with the February 12th circular, which clearly means that a lot more NPAs will have to be recognized and new could be created, because even one day default, one day overdue payments will require the banks to start a resolution process. How will this play out for the banking sector, which was expecting some reprieve? Mr. P.S. Jayakumar, Managing Director and CEO of Bank of Baroda, joins us now. In a bit, the Chairman of Bank of India will also be joining us. Good morning, Mr. Jayakumar. Thanks for joining. What did you make of Mr. Vishwanathan's speech? Should you now think that the February 12th circular is a given?
Now, listen, that's the regulator's call. But let's work on the assumption it's given. The point is, as we were talking about this 30 days thing, I was just looking at our data. Now, what I find is within eight days of the 30 days, 80 to 85% of themselves auto-correct themselves. They come back to normal. And then when you look back at it, it's probably some intimation delay or some or one or the other forms of communication issues, but they sort themselves out. Mm-hmm. For the rest of them, some of them flow into bucket two. Right now, whether you follow up with the customer on day 8 or whether you follow it on day 31, I don't know what difference does it make. Mm-hmm. So I think we should not really be fussed about it. It's a principle that identify the customer early and try to work at resolution early.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, what about
but you should look at the data around how SMA1 actually works. Mm. No, as it actually works.
Okay. Now, the other point that people, bankers were hoping would come from the Reserve Bank is a rule that 66% or 75% of bankers' nod is adequate to resolve a loan. Yesterday, the DG completely washed his hands off and said that banks will have to come to their own patterns or structures. Do you think resolutions will therefore be delayed and more will go to NCLT?
So that is going to depend on two things. One is going to be the maturity profile of people who are there in that particular transaction. And the second thing is that the continuous discussions we are having with corporates to reduce the number of bankers and concentrate their exposures with fewer number of institutions, so that there is far more alignment in the way things move forward. And I therefore hoping that these kind of policies will stimulate that process, and therefore three or four people largely manage a particular account, which then reduces the risk that you are talking about in terms of set of people not wanting, behaving very differently.
Okay.
In a theoretical sense, the customer, the bank which has lent the least is likely to be most aggressive because they have less to lose.
Okay.
And therefore, they start with a better bargaining position in all those discussions. This is what I feel about it.
Okay. We'll come back to that in a bit. We also have G. Padmanabhan now joining in on our discussion from Bank of India. Mr. Padmanabhan, good morning. What's your own view? Do you also believe that this one-day default clause is quite onerous, as a lot of people have told us earlier?
Well, good morning. Yes. I mean, to start with, probably it looks as if it is onerous. But then I would think that any change that is being brought about in terms of the way the things are done would create some kind of a disruption. And I think having been on the policy side for 3 decades, I can vouch for this, that any change, there has been a resistance in the beginning, but then the system will get used to it. Now, the issue is, are we looking at certain issues which become so disruptive that there could be serious problems that we are looking at? No, in the way, I think the biggest problem that is going to come about is that what is the kind of rules that we have? And I've said this before, that once we start recognizing an account as an NPA, to get it back to the normalcy is a big problem. It's a huge new process that has been put in place. But to recognize the stress on day one and to make sure that we take the resolution within the 180 days or whatever that is stipulated, yes, initially there could be some adjustment issues, but I think the system will get used to it.
Yeah, that's exactly my point, Mr. Padmanabhan. A few bankers I spoke to said, and even I think Mr. Jayakumar just said that, instead of chasing a defaulter 31 days after the default, now you may have to chase the borrower 31 days before the due payment,
right,
so that it's paid. Is the system geared to this advancing the cycle by 60 days?
Yeah, I mean, any system has to be geared. I don't think it is geared on day one. So we will have to put in place the arrangements to make sure that this happens. So I think the important point, the most important point that the deputy governor made in yesterday's speech is that for the same project, if there is raising of money from the capital market and then raising of money from the banks, why should we have different set of rules?
Absolutely.
I mean, accepted, the capital market and the credit market today works differently. But what is sought to be done is to synchronize the two.
Yeah.
I don't think you can fault that basic objective. Yeah.
Fair point, okay, sir. Well, Mr. Jayakumar, let's come now to brass tacks. There is one set of positives for the banking sector in that surely you're going to get back some money on Bhushan Steel, on Bhushan Power, on SR perhaps sooner rather than later. Now, if you looked at what is coming in terms of income or lower haircuts and in terms of higher NPA provisioning because of the rule, where are you placed? How much worse can it get, for instance, for Bank of Baroda by, say, June 30 or September 30? Do NPAs go up by 5 percentage points, by 3 percentage points?
Okay, fine. So let's look at it. You see, the first thing we all have to kind of reinforce to ourselves is accounting policies do not decide what the losses are. That depends upon the substance of the transaction, whether it happens on day 1 or day 15 or day 40, it doesn't matter. In a period of time, that loss is going to happen. So policies don't decide loss. It's underlying company structure, etc., that makes a difference. As far as Bank of Baroda is concerned, the data is in the public domain. We have some 5,000 crores that are sitting on SDR and S4A under implementation. They do move into NPA, most of them, maybe many of them. Some will correct, and that would result in a bulge in this quarter. It will also result in increased provision in this quarter. But it is equally right to say that it should correspondingly in the next year reduce our burden.
Okay.
Whatever may be the outcome of this S4A, SDR eventually. So I hope the markets look into that. But one of the things, as far as we are concerned, two things stand out positive. One, our coverage ratio is high, about 68 or 69%. And our endeavor has been to go to 70%. I'm hoping with all this Bhushan and extra that is coming in, we may be able to go there.
Okay.
So that would be the first way of looking at it for us. So, and the second thing is, quarter to quarter, our SMA 1 has been coming down. So that's a good pre-indicator that at some point of time this course correction is going to happen, whether it's quarter one or quarter two.
Okay.
So therefore, as we project next year, without getting into the numbers, we're very sanguine about it.
Okay, that's good to hear. Mr. Padmanabhan, come in on this, because, you know, I was going through a UBS report where they suggest that the earnings for the sector as a whole could be impacted by almost about 25 to 27% because of a combination of things, the RBI new rules, higher NPLs, etc. What's your own view on how things could move now?
Well, difficult to come out with specific numbers now,
sure.
But obviously I think in terms of the overall picture, in terms of the additional stress that we are looking at and the kind of issues that we're facing, we are more or less on par with what Mr. Jayakumar said, being the bank, more or less two banks of similar sizes and having similar kinds of exposures. But then, yeah, there will be an impact, but we don't see a major blow up at it.
Okay. Well, Mr. Padmanabhan, for this industry, would you have a view? I mean, I think the stressed asset number is in the public domain, and that is quite high. Companies like Macquarie and Credit Suisse and all put it at about 15%. So do you see the system NPA rising to 15%?
You are talking about the gross or the net?
Gross.
Ultimately, yeah, somewhere close to that before it starts sort of, tapering off.
Okay. And Mr. Jayakumar, actually, this question I would even address to Mr. Padmanabhan later. Do you see banks coming in and buying bonds? That is the other area which is creating stress. And public sector banks are using the highs to sell, but not using the dips to buy.
Actually, it would depend upon how you take an interest rate view, and then you're able to act on that. And the second thing, it is also dependent upon market liquidity. Sometimes the whole market views the outcome in a singular fashion, and therefore everybody wants to do the same thing at the same time. And therefore the liquidity by itself gets kind of constrained. If that's what I would say is the is where we are today. But we've been conservative overall in managing our portfolio.
Okay. Just one more question. I know it's hard to give numbers, but wanted to understand from you, Mr. Jayakumar, that what percentage of the stressed loans could be recognized as NPLs, say, over the next 3 to 4 months because of the new RBI rules?
Okay, for us, the total amount of restructured asset, whether it is standard or performing, I think it's close to around 9,000 crores, out of which this S4A, SDR, not sorted out, is around 4,000 crores. So we're left with 5,000 crores. Not all of these accounts are going to be in problem. I would think 70% of them should not have any risk because they are on course correction to becoming normalized. So we have a risk of the balance. So that's a very tolerable number in my view.
Okay. A final question to you, Mr. Padmanabhan. As someone who has been on the other side and now on this side, how would you read the DG speech? It's a done deal now. We work with what it is. If you still want something tweaked, what would that be?
I mean, always we need to live in hope. But I think the DG speech, I would rather say that rather than putting out an FAQ, which the demand market was demanding, he has given an FAQ in the form of a speech.
Okay.
So clearly, Reserve Bank stands in the matter. He has made amply clear. And basically, I think at some stage we'll have to get used to the new order, and that's what the Reserve Bank is trying to say.
Okay.
But having said that, I don't think that there is going to be, the heavens are going to fall down if instead of 6 months, the whole issue gets resolved in 7 months.
Okay.
But the central bank has taken a call, and then we need to abide by that.
Okay. I don't know if you all reached out to the Reserve Bank yesterday. What Behram Vakil said is that the way to read the circular is if one bank reports overdue or default from one borrower, all banks will have to recognize it as such. Mr. Jayakumar, is that how it's going to be? One bank reports default, then everybody has to consider it a default?
I would think if you were to work with this 30-day, 180-days framework, then a default to one, which is unsorted, would result in the same outcome at the end of 180 days. Therefore, I think whichever way you look at it, we all have to converge to the point of view. So this is going to happen more in the larger accounts. In the smaller accounts, we're trying to be the single lender. And therefore, the outcomes are much more predictable from our perspective. See, while the discussion on the governor's speech has been around the technicalities of 30 days and all of these things, to me, the larger question that we ask ourselves is how are these revised regulations going to affect three things? A, how is it going to affect our provisioning? How is it going to affect our future lending? And what is it going to do to our collection monitoring policy? And once we put that into three buckets, and then we take what we are doing today, we don't see any dissimilarity over here. Okay. And so therefore, to me, from our limited perspective, to a large extent, what we are trying to do is kind of converging with whatever policy measures are being announced in a real sense. And it doesn't make changes to our capital adequacy in any significant way. Our lending programs, in any case, are now becoming data-oriented with GST and cash flow-oriented and information-oriented, which is also taking place. Collection programs are coming forward, more anticipated early warning system. So to a large extent, there is a convergence, there is some changes we have made, which makes us, if you say so, more in a better position to appreciate and act to the RBI policy.
Okay. Well, we'll leave it at that. Mr. Padmanabhan and Mr. Jayakumar, thank you very much for giving us your thoughts on how life will change for bankers. It's just that the recovery cycle has to start earlier for them.